So we have finally arrived at the final video, final lecture, torsion in circular shafts. And the topic that we are going to be discussing is shafts in parallel. Let's take up a problem. Okay. So what we have is, just a sec. What we have is a steel shaft, right? So that's a steel shaft and that's the cut section. For example, let's say this is the shaft. If you cut the shaft from over here, right? Like this, if you cut the shaft, right, what you'll see is nothing but a rectangular cross section. That is what you'll see. This is exactly that. Okay, hope you got the point. Secondly, this shaft is enclosed inside an aluminum tube, and this is the tube. This is the tube. So you must be wondering, sir, are there two tubes? No, it's there, it's one and same. Just a second. Something like this. Okay. So if you cut the beam, if you cut this cut this from over here, and something like this. If you cut this from over here, and let me get this straight. There is a particular portion that you can see. It's basically engineering drawing, nothing else. This is that portion. So that's what you see. Hope you got the point. That's the cross section of aluminum tube. And obviously both of them are connected to a disc. This disc is like some kind of fevicol ka jod, you know. This disc is actually attached to a solid shaft, and it is attached to this aluminum tube. So if you twist the disc, the shaft as well as tube, both of them are going to be influenced or impacted, right? So you can say in a way that whatever torque you apply at the disc is going to be shared in some amount by this solid shaft and also by this tube, aluminum tube, and this is a solid steel shaft. Okay, how to approach? Let's write all the given data. Once again. Knowing that the initial stresses are zero, fine. Determine the maximum torque T naught that can be applied to the disc. This is the shaft, solid shaft. Okay, take a look at the cursor. This is the solid shaft. Here, what we have is a disc. We have a disc over here, like circular disc. And then we have a tube, something like this. We have a tube. Tube is sticking through to the disc. Shaft is also sticking to the disc. When you apply some torque, you fix this end up. When you apply this torque over here, obviously, that torque is going to be shared by the steel solid shaft as well as by the aluminum tube, right, which is enclosing it. Okay, so you need to work out how much maximum torque you can apply so that the maximum stress induced in steel is not above 120 and the maximum stress induced in this aluminum is not above 70 megapascals. That's it. Okay, hope I'm clear. Then, since these are two different materials, their modulus of rigidity is also going to be different. It's 77 GPa for steel and 27 GPa for aluminum. Let me just write all the given data. Okay, but before that, this aluminum, this portion, that's aluminum. Let me mark one, and that's steel. Let me mark two. So wherever I use one, it's aluminum, and wherever I use this subscript two, it's steel. Aluminum is tube, steel is solid, right? So all the given data, let's write them. These are the maximum allowable shear stress for steel and aluminum, and this is their corresponding values of modulus of rigidity. Let's go ahead, let's do it. So whatever torque you apply at the disc, it is going to be shared equally. Let me try to make a 3D diagram. Let's see if that's possible or not. So it's going to be a disc. Yeah, the disc is going to be something like this, and then there is a solid steel shaft. Let me use a different color. This is a disc. Dark blue color will do the job. This is the solid steel shaft that I was talking about, right? This is the solid steel shaft. Solid steel shaft. Oh my god. Okay, and what is this? This is your disc on which you have to apply the torque. Then you've got a tube, and that's an aluminum tube. Which color should I pick? So many colors to work with. Just a second. Green. So the tube is going to be something. It's very difficult to make. This is the outer portion of the tube. How will I show the inner portion? Something. And that's the inner portion of the tube. Right? So both the tube and the shaft, they are sticking to this disc. So when you apply some torque to the disc, this fashion. One second. When you apply the torque, what is the torque? What is the maximum torque T naught that can be applied to this disc? So this is the torque T naught. So that torque will be shared by this in the form of T2. By that torque is going to be shared by this aluminum tube in the form of T1. So basically T naught is equal to T1 plus T2. And that's exactly what I wrote over here. Hope you got the point now. I tried my best to make the diagram realistic as possible. Okay, here we go. Now, in order to proceed with this problem, I would suggest all of you to calculate the polar moment of inertia for both a tube as well as solid. So this is the tube. So outer dia 76 meters, inner dia, it's this entirely 76. So 76 minus 8 minus 8, that is 76 minus 16, which results in 60. So 0.06 meters. So that's the value. Similarly, for a solid shaft, it's quite simple. Pi by 32 d raised to power 4, that is 50 millimeters, that is in meters, and these are the values. Let's do this in a much more coordinated fashion. Let's have all the values which have been given as well as which have been calculated till now. Let's arrange all the stuff. Yeah. So in a parallel arrangement, guys, you need to remember, whenever you talk about shafts in parallel, right? Whenever you talk about shafts in parallel, remember angle of twist, let's say in this case in the tube, is going to be equal to the angle of twist in the solid shaft. For tube, we are talking about aluminum, and for solid shaft, we are talking about steel, right? You got the point. Let's finish it off. Same angle of twist, TL by GJ. So aluminum 1 subscript 1, steel subscript 2. So length is same. Why? This is the length. This data is superfluous. This is not needed. That's the length. So it's going to be same. So this and this will cancel each other out. What's left is this T1 and T2. And you just need to plug in the value. G aluminum, A aluminum. Okay. Similarly, G steel. And J steel. Plug in all the values, solve it. This is what you get, right? Let me keep it safe above somewhere here. Okay, that's a very important relationship. Now, you need that maximum torque T naught, right? Which can be applied to this disc over here. This is the disc. Once again, this over here, this that you see, that's a disc. And what about this grayish portion? This is the aluminum tube. Okay, and this here, it's steel shaft. Done. Watch. Now, our investigation begins. You'll understand this. Our investigation is going to begin with aluminum, because we need to keep on checking also. The shear stresses induced should not exceed 70 megapascals in aluminum and 120 megapascals in steel. So all of that has to be taken into account. So investigation begins with aluminum. So T by J is equal to tau by R. It's basic formula. We've simplified it in terms of T in terms of the rest stuff. Just plug in the value. You already have them. 70 J 2.003 R, you know very well. R, we're talking about aluminum. For aluminum, the outer diameter is 76. If you watch this carefully, so half of 76, that is the radius. 76 by 2, that is 38.038. So just plug in the value, this is what you get. That's T1. So if this is T1, if this is T1, if you keep the value of T1 as 3690 over here, you can get T2. And this is what T2 works out as. T2. 2 subscript is for steel, solid steel shaft. Let's check. Now let's check for shear stress, right? Let's check for shear stress. Don't worry. This might appear a bit confusing initially, but we'll get through this. Just watch. Let's check for shear stress in steel shaft. Here we go. That's T2 for you. 2 meaning steel shaft, 1 meaning aluminum tube. Tau is equal to T into R by J. Simple. T by J is equal to tau by R. That's the main formula. Okay. So we have to work out shear stress of steel. So plug in this value. R for steel is half of 50, that is 25. J for steel is this much, 6.136. Plug in all the values, that's what you get. 131 megapascal. There is a problem. For steel, we know very well that the maximum shear stress induced can only be 120. It cannot go beyond that. It cannot exceed 120. But here you clearly see, if you keep a torque of 3223, the shear stress induced is 131 megapascal, which is way more than 120. Reject. Investigation fails. If you start with aluminum, the investigation fails, right? You cannot proceed. So the only option left is to again start or restart your investigation with steel now. Yeah, let's go. Let's calculate the torque. Tau for steel, 120. J for steel is 6.136. R for steel, that's steel. R is half of 50, that is 25. Plug in all the values and this is what you get. 2945. So that's T2 for you. That's T2 for you. Put the value of T2 as 2945.28 over here. And you'll get the value of T1. That's T1. 1 is for aluminum. Aluminum is a tube. And let's check for shear stress. So the formula is this. Torque is 3372.34. R for aluminum is half of 76. That is 38.038. J aluminum. J aluminum is 2.003. Right? Plug in all the values and it's beautiful. This is what you get. 64 megapascals. Okay. Aluminum. 64 megapascals. What is the allowable value? It is 70. Yes. No problem. 64 is less than 70. Accepted. Perfect. Right? So this is how you need to approach such questions where you've been given a constraint in terms of maximum shear stress. Right? Okay. So that was getting the value of torques. So you've got the value of torques. Okay, now add them up. What is the torque? One torque is 3372, while the other torque is 2945. Let me write them. Okay, and when you add them, this is what you get. So this is the maximum torque that you can apply on a disc over here, and the shear stresses induced would be equal to 64 megapascals in this tube and will be equal to 120 megapascals in the solid shaft. Yeah, obviously, right? All right, guys, so this brings us to an end of all the videos on everything that was supposed to be covered in torsion in circular shafts. Now I'm going to be jumping to making videos on pressure vessels, right? So there are going to be different kinds of stresses, obviously normal and tangential, but the names are going to be different. Circumferential, hoop stresses. That is exactly what we're going to be talking about in the upcoming videos. So guys, that was all for today. I'm going to see you again in the next video. Until then, take care, have a nice day, keep learning, keep watching, and thank you.